already announced the dates for assembly polls that will take place in 4 states and 1 union territory. Political parties have already started discussions on seat sharing. But what really caught everyone's attention was an announcement by V.K. Sasikala regarding withdrawing from politics. Well, is it a calculated gambit, or is it something to help the AIADMK? These are some of the questions that we will take up for discussion today in Polygraph. And with me is our political editor, D.K. Singh, who will give answers to all your questions. So do send in any question or any suggestion that you may have. So first question first, why do you think this late night announcement, what does it mean?
What it means is, you know, I think the AIADMK leadership will be very relieved today, because Sasikala, even if she was out for 4 years, she was in jail, we saw the kind of crowd she could gather. I mean, from Bangalore to Chennai, the road trip she took.
Right.
So you had many AIADMK supporters, even some MLAs coming around. And that could have become a threat, because, you know, it's the first time that the AIADMK is going without any star power as the leader, say no Jayalalitha, no MGR.
Right.
Now, Sasikala, it's not just about whatever influence you can say among the Thevar community. Threat was that, okay, once you announce your tickets, then all the disgruntled elements, they start rallying around her.
Right.
And she could have been a force multiplier for her nephew, TTV Dinakaran also. So if you look at, I was talking to some experts in Tamil Nadu today. Now what they point out is, like in the last Lok Sabha election, for instance, Dinakaran's party might have got just about 5% votes, but in at least 40 assembly constituencies, basically if you extrapolate the Lok Sabha result and go as assembly segment wise, Dinakaran could get 10 to 15% of votes in at least 40 assembly constituencies. In some assembly constituencies, his vote share was even 20%. In an assembly election, even 5%, 10%, 15% vote can damage you very badly. And then again, if a section of the AIADMK were to rally around Sasikala,
right,
and Dinakaran, AIADMK would find it very difficult. So it's good news for AIADMK, I would say.
But do you think the BJP had a role to play in it? They sort of, you know, got into the act also?
No, there's this Latin phrase, it's called Deus ex machina. It's like, it's borrowed from Greek tragedy. So in Greek plays, you have suddenly this plot of the story is such that, you know, towards the end, it's so complicated that a resolution looks very difficult. So suddenly you would see that, you know, some god would be coming down.
Descend
and then resolve the entire thing.
Right.
So probably, say in our Hindi cinema, for instance, whenever you have some issues like, you know, the hero is dying and the villain is laughing, suddenly you see all the thunderbolt,
lightning
and everything, and suddenly everything is resolved. So in this case, I don't know what that Deus ex machina is. It means like God from the machine. So what God descended to resolve it, I'm not sure. Probably Dinakaran would know, if at all, because he met Sasikala, he tried to dissuade her from taking this decision.
Right.
She didn't agree. So what happened? I mean, we are talking about Hindi cinema. Then another variant of, I would say, this Deus ex machina, you see in contemporary politics. So whenever you have some problem with opposition parties, there's some complicated political situation, you get CBI sleuths, ED sleuths, income tax guys.
And raids.
They appear as, you know, the Deus ex machina we are talking about. But we are not sure what happened here. But of course, the fact is, Sasikala, it's a good move by her. In a way, if you try to see what could have gone into her mind to do this. Look, she's out of prison. She's just about 66. She cannot contest elections for 6 more years.
Mm.
So her own personal stake is not much. Dinakaran would be gaining, actually. if at all she had thrown her weight behind him. Now at this stage where you have so many other cases pending against you,
yeah,
which are with Central Investigative Agency, some of them in the court,
mm.
you really want to be on the right side of the center. So that for one. And second reason is, you know, she could be biding her time also. Like after elections, suppose the AIADMK is not able to form the government again.
Then
Sasikala may come back with the, you know, with a vengeance. That
right.
Look, I gave up politics. I retired from politics. Basically saying that you have to defeat the DMK and AIADMK cadres should be together. But look what he has done.
Not able to achieve that.
Yeah, and then suddenly you will have all anti-EPS, OPS gang coming around her and she will try to reclaim her party. So that could be a calculated gambit also. But we are not very sure yet because she has not explained.
Mm.
And she hasn't really spoken about this, spoken to the media or to even any AIADMK leader.
Yes.
About her compulsions.
Yeah, it was a written announcement.
Yeah, so yeah. Maybe Dinakaran, she might have shared it with Dinakaran. We are not aware of it yet.
We'll start with a few questions that have already started coming. Karan wants to know, will BJP be able to polarize the religious pockets of Tamil Nadu? And he has another question for you. As BJP starts talks with the church in Kerala and have Metro Man as CM face, which alliance will it hurt more? So two different states that he's talking about, but the politics there.
See, traditionally, the church has been with the UDF, with the Congress. We saw in panchayat elections, because the Congress went with Welfare Party of India, there is this sense of disillusionment among the Christian community about this move that, okay, you are going with communal forces. And we have, in the last episode also, we have spoken about this kind of, you know, some unease in the church.
Right.
About such outfits, some Muslim outfits, and how the Congress has been openly quoting them. We have spoken about also how Syrian Christians, for instance, they seem to be swinging towards the BJP, but so far they haven't really made any significant difference to the BJP's fortune. I mean, we saw in the last panchayat polls, the BJP's vote share again was something around 14%, 15%, which was the same in the last Lok Sabha election also. If you look at the NDA's vote tally, it comes around the same. So BJP has been trying to expand, but in terms of vote share, it's not that effective. Whose votes will it cut? Because in Kerala, we have been repeatedly saying that thing is, even when you have somebody who is inclined towards the BJP, won't like to waste his or her vote. So eventually he or she goes to the Congress.
Right.
So if BJP gets stronger, these votes actually they'll be able to eat into the Congress's vote share, in fact. How it works out, we don't know who will hurt more. When it comes to Sridharan and his chief ministerial candidature, it's more of a projection because BJP is into expanding its base in southern India.
Yeah.
In all the states, you see the BJP getting super active. So BJP is not aiming something in this election, but
preparing the groundwork.
Preparing the ground and expanding its footprint. So probably not in this election, by next election, you will see the BJP actually becoming a force to reckon with there.
And the second question about how BJP will be able to polarize the religious pockets of Tamil Nadu.
We don't know that because, you know, AIADMK will be very careful about this. Because if BJP is its alliance partners and it goes on this Hindutva agenda, it will be difficult for the AIADMK to actually retain its own vote bank. There may be some unease among its support base. So AIADMK won't really allow the BJP to go that far. But still, we know the BJP's politics. Somewhere these factors will start coming in. So here if the Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu is speaking against the CAA.
Right.
I mean, don't expect Yogi Adityanath to go there and again talk about CAA. So these bargains, you know, there will be a lot of bargaining about the kind of themes that the BJP talks about, the issues that the BJP raises. When BJP decided to go for that Vetrivel Yatra, I mean, AIADMK put its foot down. AIADMK does not want any backlash from others, because in Tamil Nadu, actually, Tamil Nadu does not have this tradition of this communal politics, actually. That does not work in Tamil Nadu. How far the BJP will go in trying to polarize, we don't know. But so far, the BJP's narrative has been around development, infrastructure development especially. We have heard the Prime Minister talking about it, many of the BJP leaders talking about it. But closer to the elections, what the BJP will do, I will say.
Another question from Ram Kumar Ganesan is, how will DMK and Congress split seats? And will BJP plan to poach unlucky DMK candidates that, you know, who would not be given tickets?
Quite possible. That's why DMK, you know, DMK wants to retain its whole leg, so that if the push comes to shove, DMK has enough MLAs to form the government on its own without being encumbered by, you know, alliance partners. So it is looking to contest about 170 to 180 seats. Coming to DMK and Congress seat sharing negotiations, you know, the DMK is not ready to give the Congress more than 18, actually.
Yeah.
Negotiations have been happening, and Congress's initial thing was, okay, you have to give us 50 seats, because Congress is looking at the Lok Sabha performance. Now, in the Lok Sabha, Congress was allotted 9 seats as it shared in that alliance, and it won 8. So Congress wants that result to be factored in its seat sharing negotiation. But the DMK has a different yardstick. I mean, DMK is talking about 2016 assembly election, when the Congress was given 41 seats, it won just 8. In 2011 also, the Congress had done a very hard bargain in 2011, and if many of you may recall, like, it was like about to split. And finally, the Congress ended up getting 63 seats, and it won just 5. So the track record of the Congress has been that it has been liability for the major partner, not just for the DMK. We have seen in other states also. We see how the Congress actually pulled Tejaswi Yadav down in Bihar.
Right.
And if you look at the party track record in other states, it's the same. So DMK is not ready to cede its ground yet. Let's see, and DMK has no, you know, Rahul Gandhi has been traveling around Tamil Nadu. And basically he has been trying to show, trying to flex his muscle that, you know, the Congress is still popular, Congress still counts. But I don't really see the Congress, the DMK leadership getting much impressed by it. If at all, the DMK is already uncomfortable that the Congress is trying to run a solo show without taking the DMK into confidence about it. Or without, you know, you have to go with your partner, with the DMK. So Congress is trying to have this solo thing. How the DMK responds to DMK is unhappy, of course. DMK is aware of the fact that the Congress may pull its down also. And DMK has no reason to surrender to the Congress. Congress's vote share is what? About 6% best even in alliance. In the last Lok Sabha election, I think Congress's vote share went up to around 13%, a bit little below 13%. But that was in an alliance with the DMK. So Congress on its own, how much can it bring to the DMK is not very sure. And DMK is not very impressed by it, as I've said.
Well, Manoj has a comment. Happy that Print is having their eyes on Tamil Nadu politics. Thanks for that. But he wants to know, is there any chance for AIADMK to admit Sasikala in near future? Speculations are quite rife in Tamil Nadu.
Not before election, because look, the way Panneerselvam and Palaniswamy had come together to dislodge her. She was about to be sworn in as the chief minister, if you recall. She had been elected the AIADMK legislative party chief. Then the court verdict came and she went to prison, and then both of them came together and dislodged her. I mean, she was expelled from the party. So if Sasikala comes back, she becomes the leader. So what happens to Palaniswamy and Panneerselvam? Because now they think that they have become the leaders. They are running the AIADMK and they have done a fairly good job as administrators. So AIADMK, what we were thinking that without Jayalalitha, it will just crumble. It has not happened.
Mm-hmm.
But Sasikala comes, these leaders lose their voice and they will be a power tussle. And that was why both were very clear that they do not want Sasikala on board. Even though BJP was interested. So in January, when Palanswamy came to Delhi, he met Amit Shah and others. He went back, he declared that there is no place for Sasikala in the IDMK. Sasikala or Dinakaran. So they are very clear about it. But that is before the election. After election, I said, if the AIDMK loses, you will see this power tussle happening again.
Another question from Sankalp is, DMK has more than an even chance of forming government in Tamil Nadu, given EPS is battling strong anti-incumbency. What is the need for them to engage with Congress?
That's what, but they have been allies, in 2011 they were allies, 2016 they were allies, 2019 election also they were allies. Congress, actually DMK depends on the Congress for Muslim votes. For whatever it's worth, if Congress contests alone, I don't know how much it will secure it's on its own. But for Muslim votes, DMK wants Congress to bear down. And then, a section of Dalits also, like, Congress has presence in some certain pockets of Tamil Nadu. And DMK does not want to lose that. So as far as possible, DMK would like to accommodate the Congress. But not to give the Congress 40 seats or 50 seats as the party desires. I mean, 18-20 is the best they can offer. And I won't be surprised if Congress pushes it beyond a point. DMK would say, okay, fine, then we just go ahead, we are going alone.
So. Sameer wants to know, does Dinakaran even have the required money to fight in Tamil Nadu on his own or even 100 seats?
Well, one thing you have to give him, many leaders have left Dinakaran. So Dinakaran founded his party in 2018, I think it was March 2018. And after that, apart from one assembly by poll which he won, I mean, his party's performance has been dismal. He did not win a single seat in Lok Sabha or in by polls, other by polls actually.
Right.
So very dismal performance. Still, he has been able to keep the party afloat or together probably, even if some leaders have left. So obviously, he has enough resources to keep them together. He has been contesting. He is saying he is going to contest or he is going to form an alliance with other parties, some kind of third front or fourth front, whatever comes out. Let's see what happens. But in terms of resources, I don't really see him lacking there. At least there is no such indication coming so far in the past 3 years that his party has been there.
Tarush wants to know, he's talking about other states now, isn't BJP wasting its resources to fight in South? Rather, it should spend all its resources fighting in West Bengal and Assam.
Well, this BJP is very different from what you or I have been used to all these years. I mean, who'd expect the BJP to have so many, to be governing so many states in the Northeast? In Assam also. For 15 years, you had the Congress, and we thought that BJP was finished. BJP never gave up. Who could have imagined that BJP would dislodge the left from Tripura? Well, Congress was the main opposition party, but BJP is right there. So you have to give this to the BJP leadership, that they start preparing for this much, much in advance. And they keep working, and they are at it all the time. Whether they succeed or not, they never give it up. Yeah, in West Bengal, of course, but if you look at their preparation in West Bengal, most of their focus is on West Bengal only. So you may have, somebody like BJP President JP Nadda visiting Kerala or the Prime Minister going to Tamil Nadu.
Or the
Kerala.
Union Home Minister.
But most of them, most of the energy is focused on West Bengal. Now, Neelam, for instance, did this story how the PM is planning to address about 20 rallies in West Bengal. And Nadda and Amit Shah, they're planning to hold about, 50 each?
Yes.
So the entire focus is there, but they're not giving up on their expansion plan in these states also, say Tamil Nadu or Kerala, or even Puducherry for that matter. In Puducherry, I don't know whether you have been abreast of what is happening there. Now in Puducherry also, BJP wants its own chief ministerial candidate. And that has become a big trouble for NR Congress, that is Rangaswamy's Congress, because Rangaswamy wants to be declared the chief ministerial candidate. He was the chief minister earlier. But BJP is not declaring a CM yet, even though the party does not have a single MLA. I'm not talking about the nominated ones. But the BJP is bargaining very hard even in Puducherry. So that tells you about the party and the way it goes about its business of expansion.
Hitesh wants to know, will Sasikala return as the chief supremo of AIADMK?
Depends on election results. We have discussed it. If AIADMK loses, probably she'll be back in the reckoning.
Hitesh also has another question. He's asking, do you have any idea about the seat sharing formula in NDA and UPA in Tamil Nadu?
Tamil Nadu, look, again, as Neelam covers the BJP, and she has been telling me, now, the BJP has a list. It's very ambitious, actually. BJP has identified 60, what they call, grade A seats.
Right.
So where they have a good chance to win, 60. And then another 60, which they have categorized as grade B. So obviously, it looks very, very ambitious. But again, the AIADMK leadership is not ready to part with more than 20 seats. So that's the realistic expectation they have. But the way the BJP might have resolved the crisis at the current stalemate within Sasikala and the AIADMK leadership, and BJP should be claiming more, because BJP is contributing more than what it can do in the electoral field. There are many other ways in which BJP is helping.
Another question from Soham is, he wants to know, will the BPF joining the Congress in Assam bolster the chances of the Congress alliance in Assam, and does the BJP have to win virtually all the seats in Upper Assam to retain power?
Not really. See, BPF, if you saw the BTC election, the council election, BPF managed about 17 seats. So when you talk about Bodoland Territorial Council, it covers about 15 assembly seats. And BPF has not lost steam there, although the BJP has gone for UPPL, so which is ready to act, or which is more inclined to accommodate the BJP than BPF was. BPF was with the Congress also, if you recall. In 2006-11, they were part of the Congress alliance. Now they are back. Of course, it will help the Congress, at least in BTC areas, because even in the council election, although the BJP managed to get rid of Mohilari and have UPPL on board, but even then, the fact that the BPF managed to win 17 seats tells you that it's not a spent force yet. So let's see what happens, but as it looks like, it should be helping the Congress.
I'll just take two last questions. Ram Kumar Ganesan, he wants to know, how big an impact will Kamal Hassan make in splitting votes or winning? And Sameer Raut wants to know, BJP inducted two retired High Court judges. What's your take on that?
Well, on the first, I don't really see Kamal Hassan making much of a difference. He hasn't. He has been around for a few years. We saw his party. His party is struggling. It's just that he is Kamal Hassan, and so he gets headlines and people hear him. But when it comes to voting, you know, if Kamal Hassan was a part of any of these dominant parties, say AIADMK or DMK, he would have been a force multiplier probably. But then as part of a possible third front, when you have a small 2-3 parties coming together with him, I don't really think he'll make much of a difference. As for judges joining, I mean, there is nothing in the Constitution of India that stops them from doing that. And the two judges who joined, if you look at the judgments earlier, I mean, I don't want to comment on judgments, I'm sorry, but what I'm saying is they have been actually airing the BJP's views earlier also after retirement. So it's fine. I mean, you know, BJP's strategy, it's not just about judges. You see the BJP basically wooing film personalities. So even if in West Bengal, Prasenji may not be a politician, he may not be willing to be seen as BJP, but then you go meet him, or he comes and meets you, and the message goes. Cricketers, right. And Sourav Ganguly is not ready to join the BJP. I mean, not yet.
Yes.
But then he goes to meet the governor so very often. You know, he meets the governor, then you see him doing other things, which give you the, in BCCI, for instance, he's there with you often see him with Amit Shah's son. So the signal goes. So it's about, you know, getting your acceptability among the people that you also matter. It's not that, you know, we are, as Mamata Banerjee says, we are an outsider. Or in Kerala or Tamil Nadu, if people were to project them as outsiders. So if you have somebody like Sridharan on board, you have somebody like Mithun Chakrabarty, who is ready to entertain RSS chief. If you have all the film personalities coming, you have other artists gathering. Jawadekar was there in Kolkata, and you saw all the film personalities coming to him. So you have all the pictures. People see that, okay, the party is accepted by icons from different fields, and that helps the BJP.
Thank you for such a detailed analysis. Well, in our way of looking at it, it is definitely a developing story. We will get to know what exactly is going on, and at the same time, all print reporters will be reporting on the assembly elections. So do track our website as well as our social media. Thank you.
Thank you.